Hi, this is Farooq Hashmi from thinkingneuron.com. In this video, I'm going to discuss that question which I ask to every candidate whom I'm evaluating for a data science position. How did you measure your predictive model's accuracy? This single question can differentiate a person who has just the theoretical knowledge versus a person who has practically implemented the models, and if they have really worked in a project, they have explained the model's accuracy to a client. So this difference can be shown in this answer. So I'll discuss about the key points which you should make sure are present in your answer. And after that, I'll discuss about some of the common mistakes which young data scientists in the industry make during their initial parts of the career. You should avoid these mistakes because this may lead to the rejection of the predictive model which you have built. All right, so let's get started. The ideal answer for measuring the accuracy of predictive models is different for regression and different for classification. For regression, the answer is 100 minus MAPE. And what is MAPE? The mean absolute percentage error. Okay, so what do we mean by absolute percentage error and why it represents the accuracy? I'll discuss that shortly. And along with mean, you can also utilize median for regression because sometimes there are huge outliers, and to nullify its effect, you can look at the median. For classification, the 1 point answer for accuracy purposes is F1 score. So the moment you say F1 score, I will understand that yes, you have explained this to a client, or at least you have practically implemented it if you're answering F1 score. As compared to AUC, because AUC is good for binary cases. The moment you have multi-class classification, like when the classes like what is the priority of the incoming ticket? So P1 or P2 or P3, you have to classify against these three values. So in these scenarios, the AUC can be calculated, but some extra one versus all calculation needs to be done by converting each of these levels into each of these values into one hot encoded format. Okay, so F1 score is the preferred metric. So to sum up, the accuracy measurement for regression is done using 100 minus MAPE while you are explaining to your client, and for classification it is done using F1 score. Okay, this is the 1 point classification metric. Now, F1 score is based on precision and recall. So how it is calculated and computed, we will take a look shortly. A common mistake in this is when people are answering and they have learned just theory out of the jumble, like they jumble up and one common mistake people do is like when they have memorized stuff, when I ask them about their regression model, they'll say precision recall. I'll immediately reject that person because they have just memorized everything. If you have really worked in the industry, if you have really implemented, then you will never mistake F1 score for regression use cases or absolute percentage error for classification use cases, because you know these cannot be computed for the other use case. Like you cannot compute APE in classification use case, or you cannot compute F1 score or precision recall in regression use cases. All right, so make sure you answer appropriately. All right, now let's understand these in a little bit more depth. When you are calculating the accuracy for regression, you know that the regression model is producing a continuous number. So whenever you are predicting a continuous number, you are doing regression. So continuous number like what? So if you are predicting the sales of an organization, or let's say you are predicting how many number of passengers will come, if you are predicting the demand of any product, like let's say Dove soap. So how many units of Dove soap will be sold in the upcoming month? So you are predicting a continuous number which can vary between some range. Okay, so I'm just assuming that you are well aware of what is a regression modeling technique. So the accuracy is computed on test data, and the test data can be generated either using random sampling or k-fold cross validation, whatever the technique is, so whichever is generating. So basically on the test data set, on the test portion, what do? You have some original values and you have certain predictions. Like, let's take this example. 20 is the original value and 25 is the prediction. Now, what is the difference between this? So if you calculate the mathematical percentage difference between 20 and 25, how will you calculate it? So the equation would be like 20 minus 25 divided by 20. So we can generalize this and put it in form of a formula: original minus prediction divided by original. So this basically gives me the percentage difference between 20 and 25, or let's say the original and prediction. So here, as you can see, I have computed it already. So it is 25%. So 25% is the error which I am making. So this is absolute percentage error, because I am taking an absolute of the numerator. Okay, and then multiplying it, the whole thing, by 100. So when I say the original was 20 and I'm predicting it as 25, I am committing a 25% error. When the original is 31 and prediction is 30, how much error I'm committing, how far away 30 is from 31? So 3.2%. Similarly, 33 versus 29, it's 12.1%. So what I am recording here, at every prediction, how much error my model is making. All right. And if you take the average of these errors, what you get is known as MAPE. And to calculate the accuracy, you are doing 100 minus MAPE. Why you are doing this? Because MAPE is the amount of error your model is making. So if you subtract that from 100, you get how accurate your model is. Sometimes this MAPE may exceed 100 because of certain outliers. Let's say the original value was 1 and the prediction value was 200. So it will be a huge outlier in percentage. So in such cases, the MAPE, 100 minus MAPE will give you negative results. And for these, we look at the median value. Okay, when there are outliers in your test data set. Right, so you can look at this also. So 100 minus median APE will also give you an idea. All right. So on an average, we calculate how much error my model is making, and 100 minus that will give me the accuracy. So this is the accuracy. Now, other metrics which people use for evaluating their predictive models for regression is RMSE, or MSE, or MAE, mean absolute error, mean squared error, root mean squared error, etc. But these cannot be explained easily to the client. The 100 minus MAPE metric can be explained to the client easily, that hey, look, this is the original number and this is the prediction, and I'm just comparing how far away my prediction is from your original value. Okay, so this way the client understands it easily. But if you try to give some RMSE number or MSE number, that hey, my model is having this much MSE number and it is the lowest. So that lowest number does not really make sense to the client, because it's a relative thing. You can use these metrics to evaluate your hyperparameters. So when you are training, let's say a decision tree, so you can evaluate what max depth is working, what criteria is working, how many number of leaf node values are working, etc. So the hyper parameters can be tuned using these metrics, but when you have done tuning the model, when you are deploying it, then accuracy is measured using 100 minus MAPE to explain to the client easily. All right. So do not use these in your answer. Try to use 100 minus MAPE as your answer when you are giving it for the regression use cases. For classification, we know that classification is something when you predict a class and what kind of answers you are giving using a classification model. You are giving the answers like whether this loan should be approved or not, whether this transaction is fraudulent transaction or not. So this yes or no answer could be also 0 to 1, 0 or 1. Or when you have multi-class classification, so you can have like P1 or P2 or P3 or class A, class B, class C, class D, etc. So when you are predicting these kind of values as an answer, you employ some different metrics. So as I talked about, F1 score is the final metric. F1 score is based on precision and recall, and precision and recall are based on something which we call as a confusion matrix. So this which I have created over here is known as a confusion matrix. A lot of people will agree with the name. It's highly confusing. So that's why the name, but actually it is derived from psychology. The kind of responses which are standard versus the kind of responses given by a person or a test subject, and we are confusing these two metrics. So that is why it is known as confusion matrix. So this confusion matrix, what it tries to do is tries to see whether you have predicted the answer correctly or not. Why are we doing this? Why are we not calculating the mean absolute percentage error? The absolute percentage error which we calculated here, this is something you cannot do on strings, right? Like for example here, the original value is yes and the predicted is yes. Can you compute the absolute percentage error? The yes minus yes, it doesn't make sense. So when there are strings especially, this is easy to understand. But even if you have numbers, mathematically you can compute the APE, but you should not, because that is wrong. You are doing classification. So in classification, when we cannot compute the difference between two strings or two classes, what we try to see whether our model has correctly answered it or not. So originally it was yes and I have predicted it yes, so it is correct. Yeah, this is my correct prediction. Originally the value was yes and I have predicted as no, so this is incorrect, so this is the wrong answer. So I can do this. I can check how many correct answers I have given and how many incorrect answers I have given. And this is also one of the common mistakes. People simply take the diagonal element, like yes predicted as yes, so three values, and no predicted as no, two values. So people will calculate the accuracy of this model as 3 plus 2 divided by 3 plus 2 plus 2 plus 1. So all the cases which were correctly predicted plus all the other cases. So this is also known as the overall accuracy. And this is not used in the industry. What we use is F1 score, because overall accuracy disregards the bias of the data. Like you can simply say all answers as the majority class and still be still have a high accurate model because of this flaw, that it will simply take the majority numbers as correct and divide by total numbers. Okay, so we really care about how both the classes are correct. So we measure how precise the prediction is for yes class as well as no class, and we also measure how the recall of yes class and no class is individually, and then we combine the precision and the recall value together and formulate an F1 score. So F1 score is calculated for yes class as well as for no class, all right, and this becomes the final answer. So F1 score really tells us like what is the predictive power of this classification model. Like if the F1 score is 0.8, then out of 100 predictions, 80 predictions would be correct, which will comprise of yes cases also and no cases also. All right. So F1 score is the preferred metric, and overall accuracy is something which you should not use while deploying the model, because it may sometimes give you a very rosy picture, but you really are missing the point of looking into each class. All right. Now let's talk about some of the common mistakes which is made by young data scientists. A lot of people I have seen use R-square as a metric for accuracy. So R-square is not accuracy. R-square just represents goodness of fit. and it actually tells you how much data variance your model has explained. It is not the accuracy metric. Yes, the accuracy metric is interlinked with R squared. If your model has a high R squared value, then you will get a good testing accuracy as well, but it is not always correct. Your model could be an overfit model as well, where the R squared value will be really high. But when you test the model on the testing data, the testing accuracy may come very low because of the overfitting. So R squared is not a metric to be reported as the accuracy of the model. It may lead to some unexpected results. So you will say my model is 90% accurate by looking at the R squared, but when the client is comparing the predictions with the actual value, they will say that your model is 90% accurate, but why the values are coming so far away? So testing accuracy needs to be employed to set up a realistic expectation with the client. And if you start talking in terms of complex measures like RMSE, so it is good for your evaluation. As a data scientist, you understand them easily, but sometimes your client is not from statistical background and they will not be able to talk in these terms. So you will have to go down to the terminology which is easier and universal to understand, like percentage difference. So this is the original, this is the prediction, and how much percentage difference is there. And as we saw, the metric which we use is mean absolute percentage error in these scenarios, right? Similarly, in the classification case, using the overall accuracy. So why people tend to use overall accuracy? Because it gives a higher number. We don't want to look at F1 score because it gives a lower number most of the time. But once again, you need to set up a realistic expectations. If you don't do that, your client will expect higher accuracy, but when the client will look at the results, it will be mostly incorrect, because obviously you are not taking into account the incorrect predictions of every class. Okay, you are just going with the majority of the class. So make sure that you deploy the model, and while you deploy the make sure that when you deploy the model, you set up the right expectation with the accuracy by measuring it with the correct parameter. Okay, so the overall accuracy is, once again, I highly discourage people to use, because it can be biased, simply biased towards the majority class. So make sure that you do not utilize this as well, because if you set up wrong expectation with the client by showcasing these higher numbers, then the chances are after a month of use or 2 months of use, the client will get discouraged by seeing the numbers, and they will think that you are just making a fool of the clients because what you have said is not proving true. So they will think that the model is not working, and this may lead to rejection of the model from production. Okay, so make sure you don't do these mistakes of over committing or painting a rosy picture by using wrong metrics while deploying the model. So I hope this video was helpful, and now you are a little more clear on how do we measure the accuracy for regression and for classification, which is the majority of the cases while you are doing predictive modeling. All right, all the best for that interview, and I hope you crack it.